honor and pleasure and excitement and gratitude, Dr. David DeMatthews.
Let me crack open this bottle of water. All right. Thank you, Monica, and thank you to everybody in this room tonight. Before I begin, please know that I'm really humbled and grateful for the opportunity to speak with you tonight. At each annual UCA convention, it's the outgoing president's job to share some thoughts on the state of the field. Serving in this role the past year has provided me with a really unique vantage point. I've met so many amazing doctoral students, faculty, and education leaders, and I can firmly say our field is making an important impact. And as Monica said, I always get to the impact. For those of you who know me, you probably know that I'm direct, somewhat plain spoken, and have a constant sense of urgency when it comes to work. It can be a little annoying, I think. So let me cut right to the chase. Public education in the United States is increasingly under attack, and our field must be continue to be adaptive to counter this attack. And why should we care? Because public education is central to our democracy, which I'd also argue is under attack, our culture, our economy, and this national commitment to the American dream. We've seen accelerated budget cuts, privatization efforts, school closures, whitewashed curriculum, attacks on queer and trans students, and right-wing attacks on teachers and administrators. So the goal of my speech tonight is to compel our field to draw on its assets, be more adaptive, and work collaboratively and strategically in response to this attack. And while we do that, we have to keep on preparing school leaders who are willing and able to create and sustain socially just schools. I believe we are uniquely positioned at national, state, and local levels where our faculty, our students, and our graduates live to do this work. And now is absolutely the time. So viewing our field as a family can help us think about what we can begin to do. So tonight I'll begin my remarks discussing the meaning of family. And ever since I've been at UCEA, the word family is often evoked here by past presidents and members in particular. Next, I'll offer a new metaphor, a forest. So for millennia, humans have looked to nature for inspiration and problem solving. I will focus on trees and the forest because of their resiliency to environmental changes, adaptiveness, connections, and deep roots. Then I will explain how viewing our field as a forest will enhance our collective impact and help counter the attack on public education. I will conclude with how we can all be more adaptive, connected, and rooted in our work. Find this clicker now. Would you mind changing the next slide? All right. So family, let's get started with family. We learn a lot from our families. Families taught me important values, provided me with stability, a sense of duty, and has always been there to celebrate successes and to get through bad situations. The COVID-19 pandemic has reminded each of us, I hope, the importance of family, with more than 1.1 million Americans having perished to the virus. Loss can be a strong reminder of the impermanence of life and the importance of our closest relationships. So my mother and father, I can kind of see you, Donna and Lewis, travel from New Jersey to share this very special moment with me tonight. Of course, I would not be here without them. They brought me into this world, and as my mother still reminds me, she can take me right out of it too. But hopefully she won't have to do that tonight. So allow me to briefly tell you a little bit about my family. So you all know my last name is DeMatthews, but our family name was DeMatteo. The name was changed about a century ago due to some anti-Italian sentiment at the time. My mother's maiden name is Pepe. We're descendants of immigrants, primarily from southern Italy, who settled in New York and New Jersey at the turn of the 20th century. They arrived here poor, drove trucks, cut meat, collected trash, cleaned clothes, built roads, raised their families, and fought in wars for this country. Education was valued, but often out of reach because bills needed to be paid and empty stomachs needed to be filled. On the screen is a collection of pictures of my family, including my paternal grandfather, Louis DeMatthews Sr., who left school and joined the Civilian Conservation Corps as a teenager. So he is in the pictures on the far right. In the years before he was drafted to fight in the Pacific Theater of World War II, he labored on public works projects as part of President Roosevelt's New Deal. The money he earned was sent home to his family struggling to get through the Great Depression. Like my grandfather, my parents also cared for their parents, siblings, and sacrificed for all of us. I grew up with my parents and also my brother, but also my grandmother and my aunt who had cerebral palsy. The DeMatthews and Pepe families are hardworking and they look out for each other. That is the cultural capital that was passed to me growing up in my family. At this moment, she's already told me this, but I wrote this before she told me. I knew my mom would sentimentally be reflecting on how her father, who's on the other side of the screen, who had a sixth grade education because he also needed to work, will feel knowing his grandson is a tenured professor and a president of a national association. If I were a tree in a forest, my parents and family would be my roots. So thank you, Mom and Dad. Many of us in this room have similar family stories, which provoke a sense of duty as well as commitment to education. Hopefully, we all know how lucky we are to be in our positions, and we want every child to have the same opportunities or better. However, just because we are lucky doesn't mean our jobs are easy. Being a graduate student, an untenured professor, a clinical professor on a two-year contract, or even a tenured professor can be difficult. We devote our time to advancing knowledge and practice, and inherent to this work is failure, because we learn by trying, failing, dusting ourselves off, and trying again. Yet knowing that failure is part of the success process is not always reassuring, especially with high-stakes dissertation defenses, job talks, and tenure contract renewal decisions weighing in the balance. These challenges can be especially hard on first-generation college students, who may already feel out of place. For our first-gen students tonight, I want you all to know I felt this same way too. But within UCEA, there are kind and generous people that really make this institution special. I would not be standing here without the support of my UCEA colleagues, too many to name, but my presence on this stage is testimony to that fact. Whether they know it or not, each helped me lift the heavy weight of imposter syndrome and overcome a pretty constant fear of rejection and failure. If I were a tree, I guess my UCEA family would be my son. So our family is a source of strength that enables us to do things we wouldn't believe are imaginable. So while the family metaphor fits, and allows us to work collaboratively and to advance our career and personal goals, I want to point out the obvious. We're not a family. We're colleagues in a professional network focused on pre-K through 12 educational leadership. And the end goal of this work should be clear: improve schools and the lives of children. I emphasize that fact that we are not an actual family because I believe a different metaphor is more fitting. I offer to you that we are a forest, and each of us are individual trees connected within that forest. I'm not really a metaphorical person in general, and so some of you might be skeptical, like I initially was, about this forest metaphor. Let me share a few similarities to help make my case. So first, forests are critically important to humankind, just as our field is. Forests are life-giving and ensure every living thing on Earth has a future, because they absorb carbon dioxide, release oxygen, and help cool the Earth. The field of educational leadership is also important to humankind. In the U.S. alone, there are roughly 100,000 schools, 3 million teachers, and nearly 50 million students. And for more than 100 years, school leaders and teachers have been trained by faculty and educated using our field's research. Our public schools and their leaders work with teachers and families every day to determine what we teach children about our past, what children should feel and believe about the present, and what they can hope and aspire to be in their future. Public education is also the starting point for virtually every profession in our society, including doctors, lawyers, engineers, nurses, teachers, cancer researchers, and the all-important education leadership professor. It's also the starting point for tackling climate change and inequality. And so this is not hyperbole. Few fields are as critically important as ours. And I just want to say that to you all. Allow me to make another comparison. Each tree is unique. Some trees sprout up in fertile soil, spread their roots, and grow straight toward the sky. Other trees sprout in rocky or sandy terrain, on a cliff, or at the foot of a river, which prompts each tree to grow differently. There are also multiple species of trees within a forest, and tree diversity is important because different species have distinctive strengths contributing to the forest's overall health. We also have scholars and students with differing identities, starting points, experiences, and trajectories. Diversity within the academy allows us to collectively pose new questions, utilize new methods, draw more impactful conclusions, and learn from one another. Our field and forests are also similar because of their connectedness. Scientists have found evidence that trees work together, communicate, and aid one another through fungal networks that connect root tips across a forest. So everybody here has probably heard about the World Wide Web, or at least I hope. But have you ever heard of the Wood Wide Web? This is actually a thing that scientists say. They use this term to describe this dense network in which information spreads across among trees in a forest. Our field also has important connections. Doctoral advisors shape aspects of our professional identity. Formal and informal mentoring programs provide socialization, and journals and research conferences like this one disseminate important results and nourish creativity. Nature is also collaborative, not just harsh and competitive as Darwin theorized. Trees within forests help one another, even as they compete for water and sunlight. This cooperation is not accidental or only among trees of the same species. There seems to be a sense among trees that their well-being is dependent on the overall health of the forest. So think about it. If the canopy that protects trees is fractured, a weaker tree can fall and die. Then the hot sun bakes the moist, nutrient-rich forest floor that trees depend on. Heavy winds enter through the space in the canopy, and more trees are damaged or knocked over. And obviously, trees can't pick up and move to a better location. So they have evolved to work together. We too cooperate, even as we compete for space in journals, grants, and jobs. We mentor, we engage in peer review, and a range of other activities, mostly unpaid, to nourish our field, and not simply for our own benefit. Of course, a few trees do not play well with others, hoard resources, and push into other trees' canopies. Please don't point in the room, but we might know a few similar individuals, but I hope they are the exception that proves the rule that this field and this community is cooperative. So being like a forest is exactly what I believe is needed for this mounting attack on public education. Let me acknowledge that our public schools are imperfect and have always been. But a strong, universal public education is vital to our nation, our democracy, and to guaranteeing that the right that every child has a free and high quality education. Millions of Americans across generations have fought to create, improve, and gain access to this system, given its purpose and its potential. Yet for several decades, we've seen cuts to public education, the proliferation of ineffective policies, and now harmful propaganda, mostly pushed out by the political right. Let's start from the Great Recession in 2008, because we don't have all day. I know you all want to get out of here. So since that time, most states have provided less funding per student, and we all know that funding was not adequate or equitable prior to that. Great Recession budgetary cuts disproportionately impacted rural and urban schools, students of color, and low-income students. And that's going to be a common reframe as I talk about this attack on public education. Public schools also operate within what we now know is a failed system of high-stakes accountability, choice, and competition. Researchers have consistently documented that these business-oriented reforms have not led to increased student outcomes, although they have led to profits in the billions for wealthy multinational corporations. High-stakes accountability, the proliferation of privately managed charter schools, punitive evaluation systems, backed for more than two decades by both political parties, Presidents Clinton, Bush, Obama, and Trump, and billionaires like Bill Gates, the Waltons, and Betsy DeVos, have failed to produce promised results. These policies have also been wasteful and with harmful side effects, such as increased teacher turnover and racial and economic segregation, cheating and discrimination against students with disabilities and English language learners, and a narrowed curriculum that once again disproportionately impacts urban and rural schools, low-income students, and students of color. Since I have the mic, and the banquet can't really start till I finish, I need to just vent a little bit about Texas, a state with roughly 5 million children. So for decades, Texas has repeatedly been sued for its inequitable and racist school finance policies. In 2011, state lawmakers cut more than $4 billion from public education, leading to 12,000 teacher and staff layoffs, despite the fact that the state was and continues to grow at a rapid pace. Perhaps to save money, Texas also created a performance metric to illegally cap special education identification, delaying or denying thousands of eligible students with disabilities access to special education. Think of the harm incurred by those children and families by these failed policies. Disinvestment in Texas public education might explain why just 5% of teachers feel valued by their state lawmakers in a recent survey, or why 60% of the state's teacher workforce now has an alternative certification. Alt-cert teachers have lower undergraduate GPAs, attend less competitive universities, and are less likely to increase student achievement. They turn over at a faster rate, and guess what? They disproportionately serve urban and rural schools, low-income students, and students of color. Alt-cert teachers will likely continue to rise, given that Texas had to replace 43,000 teachers last year, an all-time high. Perhaps Texas teachers do not stay in the profession because they do not earn a living wage, or perhaps because state lawmakers have called them groomers and spread lies that they instruct white students to hate themselves and America. Or maybe teachers are leaving because state policymakers cannot pass common sense gun legislation that stops children and teachers from being massacred with assault rifles in their classrooms and hallways. So I say this is a well-coordinated attack on public education because what I described are failed policies persistently being pushed in virtually every state with differing levels of intensity, despite significant evidence that these reforms have failed. The truth is clear. Powerful special interests remain committed to their failed policies and ideology. The worst of these actors have shifted their strategy away from research to outright attacks. A new script attacking public education is pumped out on right-wing cable news every night. For example, Fox News, a company owned by a foreign billionaire, pays hosts millions of dollars to attack public education, an American institution, and teachers making less than $50,000 a year. Fox's Greg Gutfeld called teachers the KKK with summers off on the show called The Five. Tucker Carlson asked dads to dole out what he called instant justice on teachers covering topics related to the LGBTQ community. These unprovoked statements come amid an unprecedented global pandemic in which teachers and administrators risked their lives to ensure 50 million children received opportunities to learn and access services. We're living in a society where billionaires and their acolytes are attacking poorly compensated educators and administrators who, during a pandemic, entered people's homes to fix computers and help with internet problems, delivered meals, and provided important public health information on top of providing education. This attack is real, but this isn't a doom and gloom speech. The Education Leadership Professoriate and the individuals we prepare now and in the future have an important role to play in countering this attack. We cannot be irrelevant or silent. Our field, the field that prepares thousands of leaders and researchers annually, must counter this attack. We're already doing important work, but I believe our efforts can be more strategic and impactful if we act like a forest. So let's turn to the attack confronting forests for insights. Over the past 100 years, trees have been cut down at an alarming rate, while forest fires have increased in size, intensity, and frequency. Presently, approximately 2,400 trees are cut down per minute in the world. According to researchers at the University of Maryland, there's been an increase in more than 3 million hectares of tree cover lost per year since 2001 due to forest fires, an area roughly the size of Belgium. So I think it's both sad and fair to say forests and public education are under attack. Yet forests are resilient, adaptive, and can recover. Obviously, our society needs to address climate change, but for now, let me tell you how forests have adapted and regrow on their own. Many trees have developed thicker bark and deeper roots that cannot be damaged by fire. When fire subsides, tree roots push up new stems. Some trees have actually developed fire-stimulated seed dispersal. That's a mouthful. So just imagine a pine cone that's sealed with resin hanging high above the forest floor. The heat from the fire melts the resin, allows the pine cone to open, and over time, seeds can be dispersed. The forest cooperativeness also aids in regrowth as trees share resources. As a field, we too must thicken our bark, deepen our roots, cooperate with one another, and change the way we cultivate our next generation. Our work should begin with an explicit research agenda focused on the following. First, we need to know who's in our leadership pipeline. So who's leading states, districts, and schools, for how long, in which context, with what types of impact and supports, and where are there clogs and leaks in the pipeline? Because we need a high quality, diverse, and experienced leadership pipeline to improve our schools under these difficult conditions. Second, we need research focused on how leaders work with complex, highly contextual, and time-sensitive spaces. We can learn from how successful leaders navigate these complexities, resource deficits, new policies or old policies, and politically contentious contexts while consistently enhancing outcomes and opportunities for all students. These findings can help us call out problematic policies and prepare leaders for leadership in an imperfect world. This research agenda, though, must be designed in full recognition that public education is enacted within a diverse society, serving many communities and identities. This work must also be rigorous, employ quantitative, qualitative, and mixed methods, allow for comparisons across communities, regions, states, and nations, and it must include student, family, and practitioner voices. Finally, this work must be translated and shared with local, state, and national education leaders, as well as nonprofits, community-based organizations, legislators, and journalists. This is how we counter the attack on public education, through research that informs our preparation, practice, and advocacy. This work will require us to be intentional. It will also require the foresight to let go of some things that are no longer necessary or helpful. So in the final part of my address, I want to share a few more ways we can be resilient, adaptive, collaborative, and rooted in our forest. So let's shift to resiliency. Resiliency is an ability to quickly recover under difficult conditions that are acute. Last night, Dr. Ann Lopez made an important point about resiliency in her keynote. She said, children cannot resilience their way out of oppression. This is a powerful point about resiliency. There can be no resiliency under prolonged, chronic, unrelenting oppression. The resiliency I speak of here is an ability for faculty and students to bounce back from the ebbs and flows of life because our work isn't easy. Our field's resiliency is important. Is important, though, our ability to bounce back and can provide us with the collective sustained force to challenge the oppression she spoke about. Trees know about building resilience. They grow in the spring, but they take their time to rest in the winter. So with that in mind, I have one request for each of you. Work hard and give your heart to this work, but always take care of your mental and physical health. You cannot do your best work if you are chronically burned out, exhausted, or sick. Many of us have been public school teachers and administrators and were not socialized with self-care practices. And as doctoral students working on dissertations or early career scholars on the tenure track, many of us sacrifice personal time to complete our work. This is not sustainable. Please create an annual plan where you regularly carve out time on your calendar for vacations, exercise, doctor's visits and checkups, and time with friends and family. Please take your time. Take time every day to pause, to meditate, to catch your breath, to get your feet underneath you. I'll also ask you to pay closer attention to the joy in your work and less attention to comparison among peers. Acknowledge the tremendous privileges, opportunities, and joy that come with being in the academy. We are blessed. Like few others in our society, and like a lot of our ancestors, we have time to read, wonder, think, mentor, be mentored, and speak freely. Use some of that time to identify the individuals in your professional life who provide you with purpose, support, mentorship, and partnership. Thank them. Write them a note. Give them a hug. Researchers have found health benefits to thanking important people in your life. On the screen is some of my research and writing partners from the past 2 years. They build me up, carry me, care for me, and push me along so I can bounce back repeatedly. I can't see y'all really well, but dear colleagues, from the bottom of my heart, thank you. To my UT Austin colleagues, thank you. To my students, thank you. When we build our resiliency, we can focus and be more adaptive to changing conditions. Trees don't resist change. When winter arrives, they shed their leaves. As humans, we tend to do the opposite. We cling to things and have difficulty embracing change. In academia, we tend to hold on to our models, frameworks, methods, and recipes for success. That's why we mostly train aspiring faculty the same way we did 40 years ago. Many of our students leave us not sufficiently trained to engage with groups outside of academia, such as practitioners, school board members, legislators, journalists, and philanthropic organizations. And many of our programs, not UCA programs, prepare leaders in a way that's kind of stuck in the past. 3 credit hour classes on school law, finance, instructional leadership, and diversity, taught mostly by adjuncts with internships supervised by a retiree, will not get the preparation job done in this quickly changing world. Of course, our institutions have constraints that are partly tied to an attack on higher education. But we can change what's in our power if we begin with epistemic humility. To be humble is to be free of arrogance. When we are humble individually and collectively, we accurately put what we know and do into perspective. If we're really honest, all of us have much to learn about educational leadership, policy, how to improve schools, and pretty much everything in the world. None of us have a monopoly on what is known or what is the best path forward, so we should expect and even welcome reasonable disagreement. Your course, your program, your definition of equity or social justice, your qualitative or quantitative methods, whatever it is you think you know right now, it isn't precious and it isn't permanent. As humans, we tend to be overconfident. And that is something we must accept and be mindful of. In an international study where participants were asked to judge how skillfully they drove, 93% of Americans believe themselves to be more skillful than the average driver. These numbers just don't add up. Researchers have also found that individuals with more access to information on a given issue, think about a UCEA president maybe, I guess, they're more likely to be overconfident, which leads them to poor decisions. Relatedly, we must let go of the preciousness of our favorite scholars and institutions. I believe our tendency to overvalue a small set of scholars and elite institutions is limiting our ability to better prepare the next generation to counter this attack on public education. Across all fields, one study found that the top 1% of scholars receive 20% of all citations. The top 1% of scholars primarily work at a few public and private universities. They also prepare a disproportionate amount of tenure-line faculty. Many of us in this room attended or work at one of these universities. A recent study published in Nature revealed that just 20% of PhD-granting institutions in the United States produced 80% of the tenure-track faculty between 2011 and 2022. No Hispanic-serving institutions and no historically black colleges and universities were among that 20%. Can anybody see a problem here with this type of elitism? And some of our nation's most so-called elite universities have even cut their teacher and ed leader certification programs, despite having budgets and endowments that exceed the regional public universities that prepare the lion's share of teachers, principals, and superintendents. In an applied field like ours, this elitism crowds out voices and stymies new ideas, paradigms, and approaches to research, preparation, and practice. I also believe there's a very small group of researchers across the political spectrum suffering from significant overconfidence that undermines our research community's authority to counter the attack on public education. These few are often well paid by think tanks or work at universities with tenure, endowment, six-figure paychecks, and sparse, if any, experience in schools. They make claims like money doesn't matter, it's how you use it. Or we just present the evidence and let policymakers decide. Or even, the public education system is so flawed, it needs to be entirely dismantled. All of these types of assertions are decontextualized, ahistorical, and they do not reflect the obvious complexities in our world, or decades of research findings, or voices of families, students, and educators. These false proclamations also mislead our youngest generation of scholars. We'll be more adaptive to these changing conditions when we acknowledge that we know what we know right now is limited, incomplete, provisional, and contextually situated. Epistemic humility as a value can drive our field's adaptiveness if we choose to strive towards it. Let's shift to cooperation. To miss the forest for the trees is an idiom about failing to appreciate the larger situation or problem because we're only considering one or a few parts. Public education and leadership are important, but we are not the center of the universe. We cannot ignore the fact that we lack a well-funded and affordable healthcare system, safe and adequate housing for all, good policing, a fair system of taxation, a living wage, a humane immigration system, and adequate consumer and environmental protections. We also can't ignore human difference or fields that give unique insights into human development and the way children and adults learn and behave. With epistemic humility, we can accept that we need to cooperate with a more diverse group of individuals. At last year's conference, I asked our community to stretch their disciplinary and epistemological boundaries beyond the typical narrowly constructed research questions and funding agency priorities that too often exclude voices of practitioners, adopt ahistorical approaches to inquiry, and frame marginalized communities through deficit lenses. I also raised the problem we have with cliques. Sometimes cliques form due to academia's history of elitism or due to racism, sexism, homophobia, and other forms of marginalization that, if we're honest, still remain part of life in higher education. Other times cliques emerge so people can feel at home and meet up with their friends, which makes sense given the family vibe of UCEA. But regardless of reason, we must prioritize our field over our cliques. because doing our best work is what's most important to public schools and the millions of children that they serve. Interdisciplinary research offers an opportunity to break down our cliques. Although there is no broad agreement on what constitutes interdisciplinary scholarship, it has been contextualized as borrowing tools, methods, and concepts from other fields, as well as engaging in complex problem solving that requires multiple forms of knowledge. Remember that trees, they're great networkers, and they're always branching out. You guys get it? No? Okay. Seriously, I ask that you audit your CV and your Twitter feeds to see who you're working with and following and who you're not. Ask yourself, are you connected with faculty and students in other departments and colleges? Have you taken stock of the tremendous capital within your home institution? When was the last time you talked about your work with the superintendent or a scholar in special ed, counseling, or social work? For those of you who are interested in race and racism, have you discussed your ideas with neuroscientists who study how racial biases operate within our brains? Have you co-designed research, professional developments, and interventions with practitioners? If the answer is no, there's no better time than now. If the answer is yes, keep it up and add to the party. Finally, to be more responsive as a field, we must stay rooted in our forest. I ask we respect our roots, our elders. To do so, we must understand where we come from. Like every field, our field's history is complicated, insightful, and yes, in some ways, problematic. I completed my PhD 10 years ago, and I can say my preparation taught me very little about the roots of my field. I wrote a book partly to learn about those roots, and now I see even fewer scholars and students who are knowledgeable about those roots. We should know Elwood Cubberley was a pioneer of our field in the early 1900s, and he was also a racist that led Stanford's Graduate School of Education. We should know when UCA was founded and why. We should know about the theory movement. We should know about Ron Edmonds, one of the first black professors in our field whose scholarship on effective schools challenged eminent sociologist James Coleman's conclusions that achievement gaps were primarily due to differences among affluent and low-income families. It's surprising to me so few know that Edmonds called for schooling that was responsive to family background and culture. We should understand the unique contributions of scholars in the 1980s and 90s who forced the field to open its eyes and see the impact of women and people of color in leadership positions. We should be able to track the development of professional standards and evaluation tools, as well as different lines of research related to instructional, distributed, and transformational leadership, as well as more critically oriented leadership models. We should all know about Dr. Barbara Jackson and her impact on our field and the impact of the Jackson Scholars Program. We have awards named after scholars that some of us don't know. We can learn from our past, even from the flawed individuals who were once mighty trees that have now fallen. That's how forests work. The prior generation of trees, those fallen trees, break down and turn into mulch and provide rich nutrients for the next generation of trees to grow. They help sustain the forest. If we lose sight of our history, we won't have the resources to adapt and grow in this difficult time. Okay. Conclusions. Whew. This evening, I've done my best to compel our field to recognize and collaboratively counter the mounting attacks on public education. I want you to leave this space tonight remembering a few things. First, you are part of a professional organization and field that is critical to our society. Please be proud and take joy in the fact that our field is making a difference each day. Take care of yourself so you can be here with us in the long run. Second, our public schools and the educators and leaders we train are under attack and subjected by harmful policies. Our field does not have all the answers, but interdisciplinary research, efforts to translate different findings to different communities, and improved preparation can help us counter the attack. Third, we must check our assumptions and collaborate broadly because what we know is limited and provisional. And finally, as a field, we can improve by staying deeply rooted in our forests, which starts with knowing our history. This speech is the culminating activity of my presidency, which has been one of the greatest honors of my career. Thank you for this privilege. As I move out of this role with a smile, I want each of you to know that I'm going to do my best to renew myself and stay healthy so I can remain committed to our shared work. I will pursue epistemic humility and reflect on my overconfidence as a scholar. I'll seek out partners who do not think as I do so I can expand my own ideas and help expand the ideas of others, because impact matters, not citations. And I will remain deeply rooted in this forest of ours and find joy in its flourishing. I ask that each of you join me in learning together so we can counter the mounting attacks on public education while working to create socially just leaders in schools. They, the kids, teachers, principals, and education professionals need our help. Let's regrow ourselves for them. Thank you and good night.
You did well, Mr. and Mrs. DeMatthews. And what did I tell you? All or nothing, right? David, thank you as always, and I look forward to doing the good work with you. On behalf of the Executive Committee and UCEA, I'd like to take a moment to just thank all the hotel staff who have made this past couple of days go smoothly. They've nourished us body and soul. They've cleaned our rooms and made it okay for us to be here and not have to worry about what was going on. So thank you so much to all the hotel staff. It would be remiss of me not to give a special thank you. On behalf of the Executive Committee and myself, to the entire headquarters staff, from top to bottom. They make my job look easy, and I'm eternally grateful to them. I'm also happy to share with you all, you probably know that now that David is immediate past president, our new president, Carol Mullen, has taken over the reins, and we look forward to her leadership in the coming year. And as Carol exits the past president and becomes, I mean, past president, she's hoping for that. As she becomes president, our new president-elect is Lisa Bass from North Carolina State University. And we're very much looking forward to her work in the coming year. If you are joining us at the MOPOP for the banquet, just a reminder that the buses will be outside to take us over there. If you're not going to MOPOP with us, I hope you enjoy the rest of your evening. And I thank you so much for being here, for bringing the best of yourselves to these past 3 days. And I look forward to seeing everyone in Minneapolis next November. Thank you all so much. Enjoy your evening.